In this lecture, we're going to introduce the basic chemistry of life. And even though biologists don't usually want to admit it, biology is really just chemistry, very complicated, put into fantastic ways that get up and walk around and interact. But we do need to understand some of the basic building blocks to understand how we build living systems. So life needs two things to exist. We need matter and we need energy. Let's talk about energy briefly, and then the rest of this lecture will focus on different kinds of matter. So some examples of forms of energy would be light, heat, chemical energy, nuclear energy. And we can classify energy into two different kinds. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. And this is what most of us think about. When you see this fantastic cheetah running, that is kinetic energy at its finest. I also want to show you an example of kinetic energy at the molecular level. So this video is a nice example of how much water molecules are actually moving around, and the individual movements of each one is kinetic energy. This one is painted yellow so you can actually see how water molecules are moving through this particular protein channel. But I just want to show here that molecules have kinetic energy just like large macroscopic organisms do. The other form of energy is potential energy or stored energy. And this is a classic physics example. You have a rock up on the top of a ledge. It isn't moving at all. It has no kinetic energy, but it has potential energy. It has the potential to do work when it moves from a high position to a low position due to gravity. When you load a spring, you push down on it, that's kinetic. The loaded spring is sitting there ready to pop back, that's potential energy. It's the ability to do work. So these are physics examples. I want to give you a biological example. These are fat molecules. We have saturated fats and unsaturated fats. And you may have heard those terms, and we'll explain this double bond difference a little later in this lecture. But what I want to share with you is the bond between carbons and hydrogens. Notice there's a lot of these. This is a bond that has lots of potential energy. The bond between carbon and oxygen, or oxygen and hydrogen, there's some energy stored in that bond, but the carbon-hydrogen one stores a lot of energy. And so hopefully you can see why fat molecules are great ways to store energy, because they have a lot of these carbon-hydrogen bonds and thus a lot of potential energy. When we look at matter, there are three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. Most of us have heard of solid, liquids, and gases, certainly, but I want to connect this back to this idea of kinetic energy, the energy of movement. What determines what state matter is in is the amount of kinetic energy that it has. And I think this little picture is a good illustration. If you are solid, you have molecules that are moving, vibrating a little bit, but they generally stay in place. If you are a liquid, you've taken those same molecules but now added more kinetic energy, so each one is moving around more and bumping into each other, and that's a liquid. And then you reach a point where they have so much kinetic energy that you turn into a gas and they're moving rapidly around. So if you take a cube of ice and you start to heat it up, you're getting those molecules to move around, it melts, and then you heat that water up enough, you'll end up with steam, and now your water molecules are moving around really quickly. So the most basic building block of matter that we're going to discuss in this class is the atom. We're going to talk about the basic parts of an atom. There are many other parts that have been discovered, and you would want to take a physics class to learn about those details. This is the level of detail that's important for biology. So our most basic building block is the atom. The atom has two main parts. It's got a nucleus and a surrounding cloud of electrons. The nucleus is going to contain two different things, protons and neutrons. Protons have a positive charge, and neutrons, just like they sound, are neutral and have no charge. And these two particles are what are going to give the atom its mass or its weight. The surrounding cloud of electrons have a negative charge, and they're so small that they don't have any measurable weight. And while the protons and neutrons give the atom its weight and some of its chemical characteristics, the electrons are going to be very key in chemical bonding. So if we take a look at a picture here, we've got this nucleus, that's the main core with a cloud of electrons. The electrons are negatively charged, and the nucleus is made up of both protons and neutrons. The protons are positive, the neutrons are neutral. When we show this cloud of electrons, this is actually a cloud of probability. So the darker areas are where we're most likely to find electrons, but they're constantly moving around. They're not staying in one place, unlike the protons and neutrons, which are staying right in the nucleus. So an element is a group of atoms with the same chemical characteristics. So that would mean all the atoms would have the same number of protons. The periodic table of elements is going to show us all of the known elements. And so it's a summary of the characteristics of those known elements. You've got letters and numbers and names on there, and let's talk about what we can actually find out from there. The atomic number is the number of protons that atoms of that particular element have. This is carbon. The six right here tells you that carbon has six protons. Nitrogen has seven protons. Oxygen has eight, etc. The atomic weight, the number down here, is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. So we know that this is the number of protons here, and then we have the atomic weight. We can see that the six adds to the weight, and there must be six more neutrons, so we get the total atomic weight of 12 for a single carbon atom. Now you may be wondering where this 0.107 extension comes on here. This comes from something called isotopes. Isotopes are atoms of the same element that have the same number of protons but different number of neutrons. So in the universe, most carbon has six protons and six neutrons. And when you add that together, you get a weight of 12. But a small percentage of the carbon atoms out there are carbon 14. And so they actually have six protons. They have to have six protons because they're carbon. But they have eight neutrons and they weigh a little bit more. So if you grab a sample of pure carbon, 99% of it will have six neutrons, but 1% of it will have eight neutrons, and so the weight will be a little bit above 12. You might be wondering why we care about isotopes. It turns out that that's something that we use in a variety of applications in biology. Isotopes can be radioactive, and so we can use those in different kinds of processes to identify disease. We can also look at the ratio in a fossil of carbon 12 to carbon 14, and that ratio is actually a map of how old bones are because that ratio changes over time. We can even use stable isotopes from carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen to figure out where on food webs a particular organism is eating. Understanding this basic idea of isotopes and elements has some very practical and broad implications in biology. Notice I haven't said anything about the number of electrons here. In a neutral atom, meaning it wouldn't have a positive or negative charge, the number of electrons would be equal to the number of protons. But some atoms will lose electrons, some will hog their electrons. I'm going to let your chemistry teacher teach you a lot more about when and where that will happen. So we're not going to focus on the number of electrons. I just want you to understand that those electrons are going to be important in how different atoms bond together. The most important elements of that whole periodic table are going to be these big six: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. Everyone's heard of the first four, certainly. Phosphorus and sulfur, we'll talk more about those. They're going to be important in the building blocks of life. So here's hydrogen, one of our top most important elements. Notice its atomic number is one, so it has one proton, and its weight is also one. And what that tells you is that hydrogen atoms do not have a neutron at all. They're just a proton. And it turns out that one proton isn't so good at holding on to its electron. So a lot of times it'll just be a proton floating around, and you'll see H plus. That means that's a hydrogen atom that has lost its electron. The other five elements that we just mentioned are all clustered together right here in the periodic table: carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And these just happen to be a group of atoms that make really good building blocks. They're pretty stable atoms. They're friendly. They're willing to bond with other things and form fairly stable bonds. And so they have a set of chemical characteristics that make them good building blocks for the molecules we need for life.